asexuality, there's one definition that is recognized globally as the standard definition of asexuality. It is a sexual orientation which is characterized by a complete lack of sexual attraction. However, it is also a spectrum on its own, just like there is heterosexuality and homosexuality. Even on the asexuality spectrum, on one end you have absolutely zero sexual attraction to anybody, and on the other hand you have some little attraction but not enough to qualify you as a heterosexual or a homosexual person. This was a long time back in 2014, when I was trying to figure things out for myself and a couple of friends of mine. I just chanced upon this term and I just found it very interesting, and I started googling about it and I started looking up on the internet about it. And what I figured out was that there were a lot of people from India who were asexual or who identified as asexual and who had no community back in India. They were constantly looking for other people like themselves back in India, but there was no platform in India at all. So I decided to just make a Facebook page for people who might be finding that kind of a thing helpful, and it just took off from there. There are many, many, many sexual orientations, and additionally, it is always evolving. Our knowledge of sexual orientation and sexuality has been quite dismal, if I have to say, and it's constantly evolving. So till a while back, we had only heterosexuality and homosexuality. Now we know there's bisexuality, there is pansexuality, there is polysexuality, there is asexuality, and all of these are always evolving. For example, there was a time when we only thought there were men and women. So they, if they were attracted to each other, we were calling them heterosexuals. But now we know that gender identities are also very, very diverse, right? And so now these terms are also evolving in how people interpret them and what these words mean. So there's no end to how many sexual orientations there are, but I can name 5 or 6 easily. So how they would be able to know if they knew everything about sexual orientations is if they realize that they don't feel sexually attracted to anybody, they can safely say that they're probably asexual. For a heterosexual, they would know that they're attracted to the opposite gender, right? And if they were homosexual, they would know that they're attracted to the same gender, and so on and so forth. But if they find out that they just don't feel any sexual attraction to anybody, it is safe to say that they're probably asexual. Yes, sexual arousal is possible without sexual attraction. Sexual arousal is a very biological, physiological, instinctive thing that happens to you when you perceive a stimulus as sexual, right? It doesn't have so much to do with sexual attraction as it has to do with sexual stimulation. Many, many, many asexuals do. I'd like to say something here which helps people understand. Just like there are so many ways to be heterosexual, right? There are many heterosexual people who would masturbate, but there would be so many who would not. Similarly, there are many ways to be asexual. There are many people who are asexual and masturbate. There are many people who are asexual and have sex. There are many people who are asexual and really, really enjoy sex. But there are also asexual people who hate sex. So just like there are many ways to be homosexual or heterosexual, there are many, many ways to be asexual. Yeah, one of the most common myths about asexuality is as soon as somebody hears the word asexual, they think that it means non-sexual. I think this confusion is probably the biggest pet peeve of mine, because I feel like it just dismisses all the nuance that there is to sexual orientation or sexuality in general, you know? So asexuality does not mean non-sexuality. You can be heterosexual and non-sexual. And also you can be asexual and very, very sexually active. So it's not the same thing at all. It's been very, very, very exciting. And also personally, it's been very transformative. I have learned a lot from this work, a lot about Indian culture and Indian society also. When I started, it was a simple Facebook page. And over the last couple of years, it really, really, really caught on. I started doing offline events and workshops only last year. It's been 6 or 7 months. But the kind of response that I see, I feel like people are hungry to know this. People want to know this. There's a lot of stigma attached. There's a lot of taboo to discussing sexuality. But once you give people a certain level of comfort, they really want to know about these things. So I have realized that in India, there's a huge market for this. There's a huge audience for this kind of knowledge, and we're not giving them enough knowledge. So for me, I almost feel like this is my calling now, that this is where I want to go in life. I want to continue in this field. And Indian Aces, being my baby, has grown into a toddler now. But also the larger sexuality discourse needs to be touched. Not just asexuality, not just homosexuality, not just LGBT. When we talk about sex education in India, in schools or in colleges, typically it stops at safe sex. You talk about safe sex and you stop. Right? Or you talk about menstrual hygiene and you stop.
Yeah, right.
What about the nuances of it? What about the really beautiful things that you discover about yourself when you start discovering about sexuality? Nobody talks about those things. And I think that they're very relevant in your journey to self-discovery or growth as a culture or as a society in general. Look at India, like we have the largest youth population in the world. And yet we don't talk about sex education. We have the fastest growing population in general, and we don't talk about sex education. It's kind of ironical, right? This might sound like I'm bragging about it, but the question is such, so I will answer. Roughly 2 to 3 years back from now, when I started doing this work, there was nothing from India on asexuality. No articles. No news coverage, no press coverage, no videos, no tutorials, no workshops, no research, not even coming out stories so much, right? And now it is really, really caught on, and everybody wants to talk about asexuality, right? And this indirectly only benefits the recipients, the people who are right now struggling with figuring out their sexual orientation. The most motivating thing that makes me continue doing this work so far has been the amount of messages that I get on my Facebook page or on my email. People who tell me that, thank you for doing this work. Thank you for making me feel that it's okay. That I'm not the only one in India, you know. I was giving a talk in Bangalore last year, and there was this 55, 60 year old man who walked to me at the very end of the event. And he told me that he's been divorced for the longest time. His entire family left him, and he thought he was damaged. He was broken. This entire thing had happened because he thought he was asexual, but he didn't know there was a term for it. He didn't know that there was a sexual orientation. He thought he was, he had a problem with him. And his entire family had left him. And now at the age of 60, he finally had felt that it was probably okay. That I'm not damaged, or I'm not broken, or I'm not abnormal. This is okay, that other people exist like me. So this sense of belonging and community that has come up now, the people who come up for my workshops, for my counseling sessions, I have a feeling that I'm probably making a positive change. And also I feel that all of these movements, they don't just affect the target group, you know, they also make people more accepting in general, more tolerant in general, more ready to listen in general. That, oh, I was 25 and I did not know what asexuality was. Today I know. So maybe there are other things that I don't know about. Let me go and learn about them. Let me listen to people and then make my opinion, right? So I think in that way, any movement, any social change impacts the larger social setting in many, many other ways also indirectly. I would have to say that, without sounding very politically incorrect, but there are many components of LGBT which are a market for products or for services, corporates, right? And they have a lot of support from those corporates in terms of funding, in terms of other kinds of support, media support and so on. But the asexual community seems to not be a market for anybody. Take for example, let's say the gay community. There's a lot of sex toys. There's a lot of gay dating sites. There's a lot of matchmaking platforms and so on and so forth. Who can use that community, right? And so they have a lot of events and a lot of funding and a lot of push to their cause, right? Similarly for lesbians, similarly for trans also, probably to some extent, but asexual people are just not a market. Right? You understand what I'm trying to say? So I personally struggle with getting other people on board. you know, and also relevant people on board. People who can actually make a difference to the cause that I really deeply care about, not just anybody. So I struggle with that most. And secondly, with the acceptance in general, because people are quick to jump to conclusions. And when they hear asexual, they assume you've probably been abused in your childhood, you've probably have a medical problem, you probably are a homosexual in disguise. There are a lot of misconceptions, which are fine as long as people are willing to learn. But I constantly struggle with tapping into and letting them know that just wait. Like, don't form an opinion yet. Wait for it. To the people who are struggling with their sexual orientation, I would say that hold on to whatever you're feeling. It's okay to feel confused. It's okay to be completely disoriented. It's okay to not have any answers. But don't lose hope already. If you don't understand where you are, you're not able to fit into any category, it's fine. It's fine. You don't have to fit into a category. Even if I tell you there are six orientations right now, it's possible that you don't fit into any of those six. It's possible that you feel that you're completely different. And it's possible that 20 years down the line, we'll have a term for it. But right now we don't. It doesn't mean that you don't exist. Exactly. We just don't have a term for it. We just don't have a definition for it. Right? So for those people, that would be my message. And for everybody else who's 100% sure of their sexual orientation and thinks they're 100% sure of everybody else's sexual orientation, I'd say the same thing. Just wait. And you'll figure out that you don't always know enough. As somebody who's worked with asexuality for 4 years now, I'm still learning. There are so many nuances and details that come up every day. Every person that I talk to tells me something new that I've never thought of before. So it's an ever-evolving concept, and I would just expect people to be a little more patient with understanding themselves and understanding others. So what I really want to happen is that no 15 or 16 year old should be struggling with their sexual orientation. Because what happens right now is if there's a 15 year old boy and he starts to think that maybe he's homosexual, he might be able to understand it very quickly because he's seen so many songs and movies and TV series and media representation about homosexuality, and there might be a brief period of confusion, but it's easier to understand their own orientation if they're homosexual. And that's not the same with asexuality. Where is the representation? If there's a 14-year-old girl right now who does not feel sexual attraction towards anybody, but her peers do, right? She has nowhere to go. She probably will struggle for 17 years. And by the age that she's 30, maybe she'll be able to find out, oh, there's a term called asexuality. Maybe I'm that, but I'm only realizing it now. You know, what I want is that at the age of 15, 16, if they can understand that they might be homosexual, they should also be able to understand that they might be asexual and move on in their lives. Do other things in their lives, you know?